Hi, good evening. Just before I'd like to start, I'd like to introduce Peggy Jones here. She's with the Maynard Post Office, and after my droning on for an hour or whatever I'm going to do here, we'll have some presentations that the Post Office will be doing. And also with us is, in the back, is Michael Welch, who's the postmaster at the Maynard Post Office. Say, wave hi. Okay. Before embarking upon the history of the our town's post office, and I don't know if people realize it, but it's the 150th anniversary of the Maynard Post Office this year. And if you do a little bit of math, you'll realize that's interesting because the town isn't 150 years old yet, but we'll get to that. I thought it might be interesting to just go cover a little bit of history about the post office in general. For example, terms like the post office and mail have been around pretty much all our lives, but where do these terms come from? Why do we use them? The term post came from the Latin postum, which meant position or place, and it referred to a system of posts that were set up along a road, and messages were relayed from one post to another. This was done back in times of the Romans and whatnot. And also, these were also essentially roads of information. And before the telegraph was invented, this is how news traveled around. And so you ended up with newspapers like the Washington Post things of that nature. Back in the medieval days, mail referred to a pack or a traveling bag. You bring a mail bag? You didn't bring a bag. Oh. Some years later, they had to come up with a word for what they put in the bag, and mail was handy, so they started using that as well. And today, everything sort of gets mixed up. We call them postmen or postwomen or mailmen or letter carriers or postage stamps or mailboxes, whatever. So everything's just sort of got together. And another little note here is that postum is similar to the Latin verb ponere, so obviously they should have been calling it the Ponere Express. In England, they transported letters for the royal mail, and in 1635 they opened this up to the public. It used to be just for the royalty, and then the British Parliament created the postal system under the single office called the Post Office of England, and it was under the control of a single officer who was the Postmaster General of England. And pretty soon, the British Post Office spread from both the greater Great Britain out into the colonies. This is, again, in the 1600s. And one of the artifacts of that, the 17th century, is located just south of Maynard here. Any road that the mail was carried on was called a post road. And the Boston Post Road started out as a crude riding trail in 1673 to carry mail from New York to Boston. The first post rider's trip, a journey of 250 miles, took about 4 weeks. There'd be eventually a large network of these post roads, and today everyone would realize that the Boston Post Road is actually what we call Route 20 down in Sudbury and Marlborough. It's an interesting thing to note that we call it the Boston Post Road, although it's highly unlikely that is where the post road was. Post roads traveled the high ground. They went in really, really bizarre routes to stay away from swamps and rivers and things like that, so the horses could constantly get through, and later the stagecoaches. So what we see as a nice straight road today or whatever and call it the Boston Post Road, if you're actually to follow the markers, you'll find it sort of winding through and going through probably people's backyards now and whatnot. In 1693, the state legislature of Massachusetts designated Richard Fairbanks Tavern in Boston as the official repository for mail coming from England. And this would be essentially the first time the post office came to America. In 1753, Benjamin Franklin, who was then postmaster in Philadelphia, was appointed to be the first Postmaster General in America. Franklin, being the clever sort of fellow that he was, immediately did a whole series of sweeping changes to the postal system, trying to improve it, including setting up the markers 1 mile apart down the roads, down the post roads, and also helped try to improve service and delivery times even back then. He was temporarily dismissed from the position during the Revolutionary War, probably for obvious reasons, but in 1775, the Continental Congress appointed him once again as Postmaster General. One note that's different from today is that how postal rates were done, or how mailing a letter was done. It wasn't just you put a stamp on the letter and off it went. It was actually, the postal rate itself was based on the number of sheets in your letter and how far it was going. And you basically took your letter, you folded it, you wrote the address of where it's going, and you gave it to the, you posted it to the post office, and some number of weeks later, it arrived at the other end. And because distance was part of the postal rate system, it was very important to know how far apart various post offices were. And again, the postmasters were involved in making sure that the routes were accurately measured and whatnot. Later, things like rivers and eventually railways and whatnot would also be considered post roads. So you can go to a post road and find out that it goes on the water. One final note before we go on to Maynard occurred in 1829, and this actually affects a lot of things. In 1829, the position of Postmaster General was made a cabinet position, and the post offices were put together as the Post Office Department. And until the United States Postal Service was created in 1971, postmaster appointments were patronage. You were appointed to it, and you were essentially appointed for 4 years. And when the president changed, the postmaster changed. My small biographical note: my father is a former postmaster from West Springfield. He worked in Springfield for a number of years, and he would talk about the day after an election would be concerned. There'd be this large line of, here it is. We're gonna change over the entire administrative structure, and everyone's figuring out which party everyone was in to know who would be there. So every year the Postmaster General would be changed, and it would just sort of ripple down, and would ripple down even to Maynard. Maynard's first post office was established in 1850, and Maynard was still known as Assabet Village at this time, or just Assabet. And Amory Maynard was appointed as our first postmaster. By this time, railroads were the main means of transportation, and the small office was located just across the street from the Boston and Maine Railroad Depot, which is where the dry cleaners is today, across from the mill. And we actually have a picture here of this one right here, of the first post office. Tiny little place. And the fun thing is, this still exists today. This is 3 High Street. The building was moved. It's a tiny little thing, right? And this was called a fourth-class postmaster, or a fourth-class post office. And the small post offices around the country, and they still exist to some extent, were just set up in whatever business the postmaster happened to be working in. It wasn't an official government building or anything. And essentially, the postmaster earned his salary by how many stamps he sold. And where they were going. And now by this time, postage was based on the weight of the letter and the distance it was going, not the number of sheets. So they weighed it, and then you figured out if it was going to California or something, and put it on the train. Another interesting note was that up until 1855, you had the option of having the recipient pay the postage. There are postage due stamps, which actually still exist today, but you could decide to mark it up for, a dollar and send it, and the person at the other end would have to pony up the money. I guess this was the 19th century equivalent of the collect call. The post office was also known to be located on Riverside Block, and we actually don't have an exact location for that, so if anyone knows, please pass it along. In the early 1880s, a fellow named Benjamin F. Johnson purchased a drugstore from Thomas Woodhave, Thomas Woodhave being the first druggist in town, and this drugstore was located at the corner of Main and River Street. And later he moved the store to its new location in the center of town on Nason Street. In 1868, Johnson was appointed the postmaster, and the post office moved into his drugstore. This building is also where the first telephone in town eventually ended up, and would stay there, and then up 20 years later, the first telephone exchange would also be located in the same post, or same drugstore building, and it served as the town's telephone exchange until 1903. In 1892, George Flood was appointed postmaster, and you can sort of do the math here on, you know, whenever the presidential election occurs, someone else becomes a postmaster. Not long after his appointment, the post office moved to the Masonic Block, and this would be at the corner of Main and Walnut, and it's basically the current location of the Colicopy store. I don't have two very good pictures of the outside. We have some other ones you can take a look at. There is a nice picture of the inside of it with the gas lights and all the post office boxes and whatnot. So here we are at the start of the 20th century, and I'd like to sort of just recap what's going in and around the post office. Maynard was a significant center of commerce and travel. Neighboring towns such as Stowe, Acton, Sudbury were mostly farms. Mail still moved primarily on railroads that connected all the cities and towns. There were a few telephones here and there, but Maynard was still too small for what's known as city delivery. So what you consider mail today is called city delivery. If you wanted to send or pick up a letter, you walked, bicycled, or drove your horse-drawn carriage down to downtown Maynard. The post office opened at 5:45 a.m., closed at 8:30 p.m., and mails arrived at 9 a.m., 4 p.m., and 6:30 p.m., presumably from the train that was coming through town at that point. So if the letter you were looking for wasn't there, you could walk all the way back home and come back 4 hours later and try it again. Postage for a letter was 2 cents, and it didn't matter where it was going in the United States at that point. That was when the so-called uniform rate was established. You could finally send a letter anywhere in the United States, put on your 2 cent stamp, and off it goes. For the first 50 years then, the post office sort of worked more or less the same. But at the start of the 20th century, we would start seeing a number of changes, and the fellow who, do I have the right guy here? The fellow who would do this was William Hall, and he had a 17-year tenure. No, Marcus. Thought I had a picture of him. In 1902, the U.S. Post Office created a service called Rural Free Delivery, RFD, nationwide, and it also started in Maynard. And for the first time, the families living in the farms and houses on the outskirts of town didn't have to come all the way into Maynard to get their mail or send their mail. It came to them. The first RFD route for Maynard was 22 miles long, and it included part of Stowe Lower Village, North Sudbury, Nine Acre Corner in Acton, the Powder Mill, and Fletcher Corner districts. Mr. Stanley Rice was the RFD carrier, and interestingly enough, he was appointed as well. RFD carriers and postmasters were both political appointments. Mr. Rice started his route at 22 miles and pretty soon extended over 40 miles, which required 2 horses for him to complete every day. Mr. Rice was observed on several occasions returning to the post office in the evening with a lighted lantern that he used to read the addresses of the letters that were on the last portion of his route. It took that long to go all the way through. On September 12th, 1902, professional burglars blew open the post office safe and made away with $800 in stamps. One of the results of this was that Mr. Hall installed a burglar alarm on the safe, and it would ring a bell on top of the post office when it went off. Mr. Hall really loved his alarm. He would test it every day. One day the alarm went off, and a large crowd gathered around hoping to catch the burglars in the act, and it turned out to be that it was a false alarm, and Mr. Hall had to get up in front of everybody and report this, and I'm sure he didn't appreciate that. Also during this time, Maynard Post Office changed from gone from a fourth to a third class, and now it's up to what you call a second class post office, which meant that it could get a machine to cancel the stamps. It could cancel 1,000 letters a minute instead of doing it by hand. As a matter of fact, canceling the stamps before was done by hand, and all incoming mail was stamped by hand. So whether the letters were going to the people or coming in, there was a postal clerk there stamping all the mail.
What year was that?
1902? The growth of the post office required them to increase their staff. I mean, a lot of stamping going on, a lot of mail to be sorted, a lot of mail coming in from the railroads and whatnot. So apparently it was hard to find help because the Assabet mills at that point were going full blast, so they had to hire female help. So the first women postal clerks were added to the ranks at that point. William Hall, postmaster, passed away on April 14th, 1911, and Arthur Walker was then appointed postmaster in June, drawing a salary of $2,000. Almost what you make now. Just for perspective, a few hundred miles away, a newfangled machine called the airplane was starting to deliver mail between Garden City and Mineola in New York, and that was the first air mail route in the United States at that point, same year. In 1913, the postal staff consisted of Mr. Walker. The clerks were James Farrell, May Schneer, her maiden name is Legger, Arthur Sullivan, Tim Moynihan, Christopher Wilson, and the RFD carrier was still Stanley Rice. That year also saw the institution of parcel post. Basically, mail then came to the railroad depot. They had a little bicycle that they would go from the Masonic Lock down to the railroad station, pick it up, and bring it back to the post office. Remember, to get your mail, you still have to come to the post office unless you were out in one of the RFD routes. Up until then, the post office stayed open quite late, and Washington sent the message down that the post office will close at 6 p.m., and a lot of the local businessmen were none too pleased about this because they appreciated having the post office open so late in the evening. Another interesting thing that happened about this time is a rather, what I call, touching form of delivery. Immigrants from Poland and Finland would be arriving at the rail station downtown, and they would have a post office box written on a tag attached to their coat. And what would happen then is that after the mail had been distributed and whatnot, the post office employees would find out who owned the post office box and bring the immigrant to their family to reunite them. And they took quite a bit of joy out of doing this. There's a lot of other names that go with the post office, and I just want to just sort of account a few more here for people who might have relatives or whatever. John Sunderland served as an assistant postmaster. Arthur Champagne, Arthur Hart, Ida Hall, Claire Bedford, Millie Walker, Emma Greenhalge, I did that one right. Margaret Parker, Williams was her maiden name. Robert Sheridan, Jack Kelly, William McAuslin, and Connie Monahan. These were all essentially postal clerks, people who worked in the post office around that era. Here's the typical day of a postal clerk about 90 years ago. They started their day at 6 a.m. and it went to about 8 p.m. Every clerk had to be ready to work at whatever window needed attention. Remember, the post office was a little bit more than mail then. Actually, it is now. But there was the registry, there were money orders, the stamp window, the delivery window where you picked up your mail. And occasionally through time, there were war bonds that were issued out through there. Five mails were arrived daily from the railroads, and all the mail had to be come in, stamped with the date received, sorted to all the boxes, all the post office boxes, and every time they did this, every time the mail arrived from the railroad, they'd close all the windows, they'd do all the work, then they'd open the windows and they'd yell, "Get your mail and get out." Clerks had to take an annual exam of taking 900 cards, which represented the letters, and putting them in the 45 different railroad runs. There are essentially 45 different routes out of Maynard at that point that the mail could travel. Then you had to figure out which way to put it before zip codes came along. And Maynard was also one of the first post offices to handle postal savings deposits. And this basically allowed people could send money back home to their countries of origin. And on Fridays and Saturdays, the post office was packed with people sending the money that they earned in the mills and sending it back home overseas. In 1913, Woodrow Wilson became president. And wouldn't you know, 1915, Arthur Coughlin became postmaster in Maynard. And in September of that next year, Maynard residents strolled into the new post office located at Naylor's Block. And this is on Main Street, next to the former Woolworths building. It's where Tish's Hair Salon is today, and that's the thing. This was a brand new office. It was at ground level, so you didn't have to walk up the stairs. Like they call the cop, you have to walk up the stairs to get in. Which people liked, and it contained over 1,400 post office boxes. And just to compare, the current post office has 660 post office boxes. Remember, if you wanted your mail, you went to the post office. You went to your post office box. That's a lot of boxes. And on July 4th, 1916, a fellow named P.J. Sullivan started a 500-name petition for city delivery. And the newspaper has a nice quote here: "Our city cousins have it, farmers have it, everybody has it except the citizens of Maynard." And apparently there was more than enough business to support city delivery, but apparently no one just seemed to care. But enough people started to. Hudson and Concord already had it, even though they were smaller than Maynard, and so they finally took the initiative. And the following quote would be, "The mothers and the relatives of boys in the service will no longer have to trudge to the office for the letters expected. It will be delivered to them in real 20th century style by the carrier." So that started. That took a few years. In 1917, the price of a postage stamp, which was 2 cents up till now, rose to 3 cents during the war. And then after the war, it dropped back down to 2 cents. That would be the last time we'd see it go in that direction. In 1920, in March of that year, the Postmaster General instructed the Postmaster Coughlin to start city delivery. And on May 1st, they began it. So they worked out all the routes. They notified all the citizens of Maynard that you had to have a mailbox, something that they'd never had before, and or slots in their door, obviously. And they started delivering the mail to the people in town. At first, they started with two carriers, James Eaton and Harold Sheridan. And then quickly, they added two more carriers, G. Edward White and William Sweeney. And we actually do have a picture of them if anyone's interested. Yeah, we have a picture of the four carriers there. Uh, There was also the RFD carrier. RFD was still in effect at that point, and it was a fellow named Chester Sawyer who was doing RFD. So we had five letter carriers in Maynard in 1920. And as an aside, history's marching on. In 1920, transcontinental airmail was started. So the first time you could airmail a letter across the United States. I have a note here, and if anyone could help me with this, there's been a lot of mention that there were two deliveries of mail. Yes, everyone's told me this. I can't find out when it started, and I can't find out when it ended. So if anyone has any idea or can spec out the years, I'd appreciate it, just so I can add it to my records. Can't find a newspaper clipping of people saying it's starting or stopping, but everyone knows that it happened. In 1935, Frank Sheridan, who was a two-term state representative, was appointed postmaster, and he got in at a good time. The rules for appointment changed very soon after that, and he would hold his position as postmaster in Maynard for 30 years until his retirement. And the price of the stamp is now 3 cents. Basically, under Sheridan's tenure, the post office grew until it outgrew its quarters, and it was moved in 1940 to the Cox Building. And the Cox Building is on the corner of Nason and Summer, across the street from the Knights of Columbus, the candy store, I guess would be another way of of referring to it. As near as I can tell, this was not a particularly popular move. All the things that I can find out say that no one really liked it there, but it remained the post office for 20 years. In 1963, two changes came to Maynard. The first was we had some zip codes, those little five-digit numbers and whatnot. And my father gave me, I have a national zip code directory from 1966, if you want to see where things were at that point. They actually found it in a real book, $7. Also, in 1963, on March 2nd, the current Maynard Post Office, what you know today, was dedicated with an address by Congressman Philip Philbin and the 18th U.S. Army Band from Fort Devens. It was quite the shindig. Not long after that, the first stamp was canceled on the surface of the moon. And then a few years after that, the United States Post Office Department became the United States Postal Service. That happened in 1971. And what the U.S. Postal Service is it's a sort of a nonprofit company that wasn't supposed to take any money from the government. This took a little longer than planned. In 1983, the Postal Service received its final subsidy from the federal government and was on its own. But by then, of course, the price of a postage stamp had risen to 20 cents. So here we are. We're at the dawn of the year 2000. First class stamp costs 33 cents, but you know, that 5 cent coat costs a buck. Our post office has faithfully served the townspeople for 150 years now, and will probably do so for the foreseeable future. It's seen the arrival and the adoption and the fall of the Pony Express, the telegraph, railroads, telephones, automobiles, airplanes, radios, fax machines, television, the internet, and the mail just keeps going up. We get different things now in the mail, maybe, than we got. But there's a nice rhythm when the mail comes every day. And rain or shine, the mail's here. Thank you. I'd like to turn it over to Peggy now. She can.
I have a little show and tell that I brought, but first I wanted to mention that. I'm on the spot now.
How does it get there?
It leaves. We actually still receive mail four times a day. Our central processing plant is in Worcester.
Yeah, that's what I wanted. That letter goes to Worcester.
All the way to Worcester. Of course, things are a little different now. in that we don't hand stamp them. We send them in a large bin, which is machine dumped. The letters actually are sorted by machine. They're read by machine. They're sorted by machine, by zip code, by town, by street. There are very few letters that this machine cannot read. It does read script. So those letters that cannot be read by machine go to a hand clerk to sort.
That letter goes from Maynard to Worcester.
To Worcester, and then goes right on the next truck and back to Acton overnight. In most cases. In most cases.
When did you say the post office moved from Main Street by the Maynard Trust Company to another location?
To the Cox Building? A moment. Yep, that's the date I have.
That's wrong.
That's wrong, okay.
Because I worked at the post office as a 16-year-old on a bicycle delivering special delivery letters. And from 48 until 1950, and it was still there.
In 1950?
The only ones in town, remember, there used to be Chin Lee's Laundry on one side, and the Maynard Trust Company on the other side. I left there in 1950 when I graduated. I started at 48 as a sophomore. I had to wait until I was 16. Because the fellow that stood before me with his bike graduated from high school was pre-poking. And after that, I took over. And used to go in at 6 o'clock in the morning to the post office out, and then take the special deliveries before school, come back at 1 o'clock after school is out, come back at 5:30. And also on Saturdays. And in the meantime, at times you would go in and fold the number one and number two sacks up, 19 in a bag, and roll them into the 20th one, so they'd be shipped back. And also change the little the wooden pens with the insert pen points we used to use with the ink wells in school. They still had them in 1950. But it was quite an experience being down there, being only 16 years old. But it was a long way from 9 cents a letter to deliver one of these bikes in the snow up by Erickson's, and the next one to be down near H.H. Scott or for 18 cents. Then they changed it to 99 cents an hour, if you got for your wages. There was a part-time job. It brought me out about, I think, like $14 every 2 weeks or something. But in 1950, it was a considerable sum for a kid going to school. But the post office still was there in 1950.
Yeah, I didn't have an exact date. I was ballparking it. It really was.
I can remember when it moved. It was September 18th.
Okay.
They still had the Model A delivery truck from Parcel Post. It was 1930. Black fenders and hood and the autograph back. If you want to know the registration number for the post office, it's 11737.
Do you have a picture of this one?
Oh, yeah, here. Oh, yeah. You can ask Tom Hugo, you can see one of the drawers.
Yes, sir.
With the change to the merit system for the appointment of postmasters, is the postmaster still considered a representative President of the United States in these various communities?
The current postmaster is shaking his head no.
There has been a change.
Yes. Yeah, I believe that when it became essentially a business instead of a part of the government.
That's why I said the merit system.
Yeah.
I think even when they changed it from just the merit system, like when Frank Sheridan was there, he probably still was an official representative, even though it was no longer done politically. I'm sure it still was a representative of the U.S. government, but he was allowed to retire as opposed to being picked out. I think as of 1971, it would have changed.
Is there any chance a post office will move from the spot they're in?
It's good parking. Now it's gorgeous.
There's one space down there for a couple of
customer come in, the rest of them, either hit people, park there, or you can't park.
Until the trucks leave in mid-morning. I believe we're due for review by the building department in 2005. So we're there for a while.
What happens to the mail in the post to which turn it doesn't have a zip code on it?
It's called out of the automatic sorting machine and goes to a special clerk who will look up the zip code.
So he would have to she would have to hand do it, look at it, and
over time you learn hundreds of zip codes. If it's out of state, they would probably key it in a computer.
Do you have any idea what the percentage might be? It's a very small percentage.
Very small.
Actually, a lot
we
of
don't
them,
use the.
They're encoded now. They have a separate section that they actually take a scan of it and made its mail. It's actually done in North Carolina. So they take the picture of it. It would go down and they'd have people down there came and they'll actually key in the code. He'll come back and spray it on each shoes, baby. If you ever notice on the back of the letter, you might see fluorescent orange or yellow. That's North Carolina.
It's a little barcode on the back. And they actually do this remotely by computer, where they scan the front of your envelope. They send a message to North Carolina, and immediately the zip code comes back, and the machine sprays the proper barcode on the front, and then sorts it and sends it on its way. Things are a little different.
I've got another question. You talked way back when you send a letter, you'd fold it, take the post office and fold it and write the address on the letter itself?
Yes.
What do you have any idea when they started using envelopes as we know them now or something that?
Oh, you got me stuck there.
What an envelope?
I don't know. I'm sorry. I can try to look that up.
No big deal. I just
forgot. Yeah. After all, I'll go back to my notes and do that.
Probably with greeting cards.
Oh, postcards, actually.
No, with greeting cards, then...
Oh, yeah, right.
Yeah, I was wondering, the post office delivers mail and rain and sleet, rule of night and all this. Do you require your carriers to have shorts in all of these conditions?
From the inside perspective, this is what we call amongst us as the village idiot contest. And the boys buy between themselves to see who can be in shorts the longest into the winter. When it got to be 20 degrees with a wind chill of minus 20, all but one had the sense of putting pants on. One gets under their discretion, assuming that they're not using sick leave because of